amazing.
So amazing.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
So amazing.
You cause the sun and moon to shine.
I'm so glad you're mine.
Oh, I'm glad to say you're mine.
Tip joys.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
Tell them you're amazing.
You're amazing.
Shout you're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're so amazing.
So amazing.
Tell them you're amazing.
You're amazing.
Shout you're amazing.
You're amazing.
Tell them you're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're so amazing.
So amazing.
You heal the sick. Raise the dead, you Lord of all, the great I am. You call the sun and the stars and moon to shine. I'm glad to say you're mine. Oh, I'm glad to say you're mine.
We stand
in awe of you.
Our lesson tonight will be presented by our pastor, Pastor Brown. Hear ye him.
We reverence God and thank him for this another day. Thank him for this honor and privilege of being able to join you for our teachers' meeting as we prepare for lesson two in this series. And this is June the 11th. And again, thank you, Brother William Collins, for being our superintendent, and thank you for helping us in our devotional period, Brother Willie Smith. Someone needs to mute. They're having a loud background noise, and you need to mute if possible. All right. Isaiah chapter 65, verses 17 through 25. God's kingdom of peace. Amen. And I know there, as a boy growing up, they used to sing a song called, "There will be peace in the valley for me someday." And here, Isaiah prophetically looks at the condition of Israel, the condition of really Judah, the lower kingdom. And he predicts that God is going to ultimately usher in a kingdom of peace. Let's look at verses 17 through 25. But I strongly recommend that you read beginning with verse 1 and see the transition from where the people were to where God ultimately wanted to get them to. Amen. Verse 17, "For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former shall not be remembered nor come into mind. But be ye glad and rejoice forever in that which I create. For behold, I create Jerusalem a rejoicing and her people a joy. And I will rejoice in Jerusalem and joy in my people. And the voice of weeping shall be no more heard in her, nor the voice of crying. There shall be no more thence an infant of days, nor an old man that hath not filled his days. For the child shall die 100 years old, but the sinner, being 100 years old, shall be accursed. And they shall build houses and inhabit them, and they shall plant vineyards and eat the fruit of them. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For as the days of a tree are the days of my people, and mine elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain, nor bring forth for trouble, for they are the seed of the blessed of the Lord, and their offspring with them. And it shall come to pass that before they call, I will answer. And while they are yet speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together, and the lion shall eat straw like the bullock, and dust shall be in the serpent's meat, shall be the serpent's meat. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, saith the Lord. What a beautiful picture of what could be called utopia, ideal situation, ideal condition. And what something to desire and something to yearn for. And then Isaiah is saying, you can believe God for this. You can believe God for restoration if you repent. Again, you got to read the first 16 verses. You can believe God for a new lease on life. You can believe God for a new anticipation of life. And it almost sounds like the wicked gonna cease from troubling and the weary gonna be at rest. And lions are going to eat straw. What a great vision. A place where there's no sorrow but joy. A call for rejoicing. The source of rejoicing. A promise of rejoicing. The new reality, long life, housing and sustenance, safety and security. God answers prayers before you ask of whom, and an end to violence. What a dream. What a vision of this future that Isaiah the prophet pictures and paints for us through the writings of this 65th chapter. Some have said that this is a picture of end times. And yet the scripture implies that it refers to the restoration that he's going to give to Judah after the Babylonian captivity. Isaiah 63 through 66 is identifiable as a unit of thought, the whole three chapters. These chapters echo the problems of human feelings addressed, chapters 56 through 59, but they don't stop there. They go on to add elements of hope because of the power of God. In so doing, chapter 63 through 66 contrasts human inability to be righteous with God's divine ability to produce righteousness. The backdrop is again that of what the people in Babylonian captivity several decades in the future from the time Isaiah prophesied. They're going to need hopeful assurance of a better day. When we speak of that exile, we take care to distinguish it from the Assyrian exile of the 10 tribes of the northern kingdom known as Israel in 722 BC. The two tribes of southern Israel Judah and Benjamin, collectively known as Judah, came under Babylonian dominance in about 609 BC. The Babylonians, also known as the Chaldeans, tightened the screws in 597 BC. When Jerusalem surrendered after a siege and suffered a partial exile, the final straw was the wholesale deportation or exile to Babylon in 586 BC. The impact of this exile can be seen by piecing together the texts that are set before us. In particular, the last of these passages noted that Jerusalem desolation would last 70 years. The people of Judah and Jerusalem had brought the destruction on themselves by refusing to obey God. Now, I believe that scripture or that statement is so significant that I need to read it again. The people of Judah and Jerusalem had brought the destruction on themselves by refusing to obey God. And whatever is coming on our nation, whatever is coming on our world, I believe can be tied to the destruction as a result of refusing to obey God. The curses poured out on the Judeans were exactly what had been predicted in the law of Moses. And God had kept his promise to inflict such punishment. We want God to keep all of his promises of blessings and deliverance and healing and protection and love and provision. We want him to be the great shepherd of the sheep. But at the same time, we need to remember that God has promises of punishment to those who blatantly, and that's without real care, go against him. And you may not see it in our laws, but I need to let you know that this nation, our nation, this world, our world, is becoming a world that is turning its back on the teachings and the requests of God upon us. Let's look at, again, I want you to read verses 1 through 16 in chapter 65, but here is almost the turning point, the antithesis, the other side of the coin. Where the Lord goes from his vengeance, he goes from his punishment, he goes from the consequences of the choices that the people have made, and he talks about celebrating newness. He's celebrating. Look, what is the source of this anticipated rejoicing that Isaiah is talking about? For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth. The poem that begins here describes a radically different future reality. But does this refer to the ultimate new creation that God will bring about at the end of time, which in similar wording, the opening word for four leads us to reconsider, translate a Hebrew word that appears in Isaiah, where the translation is because and as in here's the reason why. As such, this word connects the thoughts of the verse at hand with those of the previous verses. It is a prediction of what God is getting ready to do for Israel. They are in misery. And you know, when people in misery, they look for somebody to blame. They're in misery. And God said, is because of you, your choices, your disobedience. But now he announces that I'm going to create a new thing and I'm going to give you a new day. As you know, after the captivity and they return, a remnant return to Jerusalem, and God had Cyrus and others, Artaxerxes, to help them to try to rebuild their nation, their city. And Nehemiah was one of those that was instrumental in that. So the previous verses announces two things: the end of foreign domination of Israel. Babylonians, Assyrians, the end of unholy rebellion by the Israelites, the end of imperial aggression would mark such a dramatic change that the language of new creation is appropriate for it. When added to the extreme language regarding elimination and unholiness and end times interpretation of the destruction and replacement of the planet Earth, it's very inviting here. But two other options should be considered. One is that a double fulfillment is intended. And many times in prophecy, amen, in prophecy, there may be more than one intent. And sometimes the intents overlay each other to the point that you can get them confused and maybe think that one is the other. But here's what the Lord is saying. If you turn back to me, better days are ahead. Your dream of what you would like to see is possible with God. And I'm going to tell you the other side. The dream of what you would like to see is impossible without God. So the second fulfillment is this end times literal. Another option is that the text features what is known as a prophetic foreshortening. The verse that follows will provide clues as to which interpretation is more likely the correct one. Here we go. And the former shall not be remembered, nor come into mind. Now, any of the above possibilities, a feature of the new era will be a kind of forgetting. The Bible speaks an issue involving requests to remember and promise to forget between people and God. The type of forgetting in view here is the kind when an event or an experience fades into the background because something more important has replaced it. And a lot of time we dwell on things in the past, but sometimes we want to move on as if they never happened. Even though we know they did, there are things that did happen, but God moves you to a new place where it looks like sometime when you look back at that old situation, it almost seemed like another lifetime. But you're in a new state of relationship. Verse 18a, and be ye glad and rejoice forever in that which I create. An invitation to celebrate and worship occurs often in the Psalter for times of communal festivity. The Lord wants us to remember and celebrate. This attitude is built into Old Testament religious expression. It is an attitude that rests on confidence in God's sure promises to overcome evil in its various forms. The wording forever may automatically cause us to think in terms of eternity without end, but the underlying Hebrew word may signify age enduring or at the end of the age. For behold, I create Jerusalem a rejoicing and her people a joy. The hope the hope, the dreams, the desire for these exiles. Remember, 70 years hasn't ended yet. They still in their suffering. They're still in their displacement. But the Lord said, I'm going to bring you out. I'm going to bring you through. So the hope for rebuilding Jerusalem occupied the thoughts of the poets, the prophets, and other leaders of that period. Nehemiah is an example, because the city and its destroyed temple represented access to God. Jerusalem was for, should have been, a symbol of all that could be holy. God gave them everything they need to be resting in a right relationship. And here they are in a messed up situation. Ooh, makes you want to cry, makes you want to pull your hair out. When you see that God has been good to some people and they should be living lives and moving forward with their life, but here they are in a messed up situation because they choose not to obey God. And God's not just going to give you his promises and his blessings because you want them. God has to be able to entrust you with his city of joy and his place of rejoicing, and you're rejoicing. It's not going to come to pass as long as you are disobeying God. Celebration is not reserved for humans only. God himself can join the celebration. Relationship between people of Judah and God will have changed. The strains and mutual hostility brought on by the people's sin will have vanished, thanks to the gods. But to our God's merciful forgiveness. Amen. Let me say this to you. There are so many things could change. And I'm talking about can change without delay, without long periods of revitalization, all that. If we would just turn to God, he can heal the land. And I know that's an idea that somebody think is beyond fulfillment, but God can heal the land. But we got to do what he asked us to do. And verse 15 of that Second Chronicles chapter 17 said, my eyes are going to be watching and my ears are going to be listening. I'm waiting on you to do what you need to do. You want this to be a better world? Do what you need to do. The voice of weeping, verse 19b, shall be no more heard in her, nor the voice of crying. As I was looking at this lesson again today, I thought about the death, the murders, the sorrow that is in our community. My heart gets heavy and I try to not let it weigh me down. But when I hear of children being killed or killing themselves, and one day the probability, I know when we cross over out of time into eternity, the voice of weeping is going to disappear because of the forthcoming change of relationship between God and his people. The destruction of Jerusalem and other cities in the southern kingdom of Judah resulted in intense grief and mourning. Reversal of those facts seemed impossible from a human viewpoint, but not from God's perspective. The new reality, verse 20, there shall be no more thence an infant of days, nor an old man that hath not filled his days, but a child shall die 100 years old. Mama, the new reality had come to a differ from the old reality. in important ways. One such way is a movement back toward an ideal of the first creation, long life. And as we consider this change, we should take care to distinguish between humans' lifespan, which at that time was 120, and life expectancy, which is now 70 years, Psalms 90 and 10. The high rate of infant mortality in the ancient world meant that life expectancy on average was probably no more than 35 years. And if a person could make it to age 5, then the chances of reaching age 70 became better. Therefore, the change of life expectancy promised in the verse at hand is a major one, is a major one. Infants are going to make it to 100. We also note that this verse provides a clue regarding to the alternative presented in the commentary in Isaiah 65:17. The new heavens and the new earth predicted there are not the same as those predicted in 2 Peter 3:13 and Revelation 21:1, which is of the eternal setting of a new heaven and new earth. This is in the temporal. This is in time. I'm going to make Jerusalem new. I'm going to make the children new. I'm going to make their goals new. I'm going to make the perspective of the possibilities of what I can do in their lives. I'm going to make it new. Since the renewal in those two passages will feature an end to death altogether. Even so, the newness promised in our lesson text may serve as a type or a pattern of the ultimate eternal reality that is yet to come. The Lord has already set in place an opportunity for man to live better than what he's living right now. Isaiah 65:17-25 provides us with a launching point for anticipating the fulfillment of Revelation 21. God has promised to create a new heaven and new earth. Absent will be weeping and death. How does that future reality influence how you think and live right now? And should it? I say it should. Verse 20b said, but the sinner being 100 years old shall be accursed. This line is more difficult to understand, but here's to me the clarity of it. Sinners may live long, but they're not going to be joyous lives. They're not going to be filled with the hope and the peace that is promised to believers. The idea that someone who misses the mark of reaching age 100 is to be considered accursed. You live that long and you miss the mark. In that case, the line would simply amplify the idea of the previous one rather than adding a new. Look, he's going to not only provide you with long life, but housing and sustenance. And they shall build houses and inhabit them. Now, that's why I believe it's the return to Jerusalem by the exiles in this part of the prophecy. I believe that this is a dual prophecy, that it looks at what is going to be the future of God's going to turn things around for Israel or Judah. And at the same time, God is showing them a greater plan, a greater hope, even beyond what I'm going to do for you. They shall build houses and inhabit them. And you know, when they went to the promised land, God told me, so I'm going to give you houses you didn't build. I'm going to give you vineyards you didn't plant. But now God is saying to them, I'm going to let you build houses, and then I'm going to let you live in them. Then I'm going to let you plant vineyards, and then I'm going to let you eat the fruit of them. The ruins of Jerusalem rendered stark testimony of disobedience long after the destruction in 586 BC. Today's text promises that those returning from that exile will regain stable, productive lives. The mention of vineyards, a word occurring more than 100 times in the Old Testament, reflects an important part of the diet and the economy of the ancient Israelites. And the vineyard was also associated with that rejoicing. Not only am I going to give you housing and protection and vineyards, but I'm going to give you safety and security. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. So this verse reminds us of the old saying, what goes around comes around. Hundreds of years before this text was written, God had granted the Israelites a new homeland where they took ownership of houses they hadn't provisioned, wells they hadn't dug, vineyards they hadn't planted. This happened after the original owners forfeited their place in the land due to sin. And sin will do you in. We witness it every day. We witness it in our news media. We witness it in our streets. We witness it in our neighborhood. Sin will do you in. That change of ownership came with a warning not to commit the sins of those ejected, lest the Israelites suffer the same consequences. And what did they do? They followed right in the negative footsteps of those that God had given them their land. Exactly what he told them not to do is what they did. Results of the exile in 586 BC included loss of houses, loss of fields, which become occupied and tended by others. The devastation was so complete that areas of human habitation became again habitation of wild animals. God kept his promise, but that reversal was to be itself reversed. Verse 22b says, for as the days of a tree are the days of my people, and mine elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. The theme of reversal continues as the imagery shifts to the longevity of a tree. Although trees are not immortal, they do often live long past the lives of humans. The promise that mine elect shall enjoy long enjoy the work of their hands. Couples' longevity of life with enjoyment of that life, creating a word picture of the people who will flourish. And if you're faithful to God, God's got blessings for you. God's got promises to you. They shall not labor in vain, nor bring forth for trouble. For they are the seed of the blessed of the Lord, and their offsprings with them. This verse ties together the previous three verses, summarizing the people's new condition to come. The phrase, nor bring forth for trouble, may be confusing in some regard, but clarity is found in that the Hebrew word translated bring forth is the same translated bring forth children. And that is a sense here, the loss of sons and daughters were predicted as an anguish of the exile. So again, we have promises of reversal. God can turn it around. God can turn things around. God answers prayer. Hello. God answers prayer. Verse 24 says, it shall come to pass that before they call, I will answer. And while they are yet speaking, I will hear. Perhaps the most significant promise in the list is right here, whereas exiles from their homeland would mean an estranged relationship between God and the people, the new era will see deep and immediate communication between the two. Thus, we have another reversal. Amen. He even said to them through Jeremiah, you're going to call me and I'm not going to answer. You know, I'm going to ignore you. The book of Isaiah opens with condemnation of the people because of their stubbornness and oppression. Their acts of piety were designed to cover up their sins rather than lead to them to correct them. Causing great offense to God, since they would not defend the poor, they would not defend the widows, they didn't defend the orphans, God would not even give ear to their prayers. But look at this reversal. He said, when they pray, I'm going to answer. The future was to be one where God listens intently to their prayers in extending mercy to the people. God has called them to make prayer an occasion for concern. When we pray properly, we become attuned to God's love for all human beings. We increasingly share that concern and act on the basis of it. Then God will listen. And not only does he promise them houses and vineyards, and he promised them that he's going to answer their prayers. But he says, ultimately, I'm going to give you an end to violence. Oh, my God. That breaks through our imagination almost. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together. And the lion shall eat straw like the bullock. And dust shall be the serpent's meat. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountains, saith the Lord. This final verse of this lesson today, the so-called vision of the peaceable kingdom, the verse at hand applies that earlier vision to the time when Israel will have returned from Babylon exile, resettled in the land, about 538 BC. In doing so, the vision paints a strong contrast to what would become the actual experience of the people. Old problems would remain or resurface after the return, yet the sinful problems need not prevail. The people turn to God fully. A new era of peace could ensue. As is in almost all prophetic speeches in the Old Testament, this verse intends to speak about a reality that should ideally come about. Yet that possibility remains always just beyond our grasp, as we do not yet live in a peaceable kingdom. The text calls its readers to pursue righteousness, pursue peace, so that we could draw closer to the alternative reality than what we're living in right now. A reality in which God reigns not just in the world as he always does, but also in our thoughts, in our actions, which he often does not, in our hearts, in our mind. Isaiah 65 is a visionary text, should inspire its readers to see beyond both past failures and the seemingly valid temptations of the present. It invites us to imagine a different world than the one we inherited, a world which old wounds will be healed, and the God-given talents of all are used to bless others. This text offers a vision of a world in which the communication between God and humanity remains open and free and life-giving. While they are praying, I'm going to be answering. When you read a visionary text, means we have to think creatively in a biblical way. Such text causes us to use our imagination so we can begin to see what God might be creating in our lives as individuals and as churches. In such a vision, God is the one who does the recreating. The language of creation does not apply just to the beginning of time, but to a new era that can emerge when people who have experienced God's mercy embrace the possibilities of new and holy ways of life. The Bible says, if any man be in Christ, we know it says a new creature, but the actual new translation is a new creation. New creation is what God desires to make of us. Live as if the time of the new heaven and the new earth were now. Live in anticipation that being faithful to God is going to lead to new relationships and new blessings and new joys. Praise his holy name. We thank God for this lesson that deals with the promises and the blessings of God, how he can give us a renewal. He can turn things around. There is a kingdom of peace that belongs to God. Brother Superintendent, that is the lesson. If there are no questions,
say no one compares.
No one compares to you.
Come on, somebody tell the Lord.
Say no one compares.
No one compares
to you.
See, I-